titled Understanding the Power Behind Animal Spirit Medicine. So we're going to talk about what animal spirit medicine is, how to use it, and its relevance during these dire times. But first I'm going to talk about my story a little bit, because I think, as all of you know, everything happens for a reason. And it's sort of interesting hearing how people come to be. So I grew up in New Mexico, and that was a beautiful place to be and a platform for me to develop my love of nature and animals. I fell in love with all creatures. It didn't matter what they were, you know, because we sort of idealized certain animals, wolves, dolphins, tigers. Oh, they're pretty, they're cooler than the others. But to me, every animal has value and has a story. So an example of that is we have tarantulas that would cross New Mexican desert land. And it was a very rare sight to see because they're nocturnal. So if you saw them during the day, it was very special. And most people, you know, are kind of intimidated, freaked out by tarantulas. But I really genuinely saw them as this sort of divine creatures. They were really important and significant to me, all the same as my dog Scooby was. You know, they both were beautiful in their own way. So it's kind of interesting to think, like, now as a healer type, what I was like as a kid. I was sort of a medicine woman without knowing it. I had a whole crystal collection, as well as I made potions in the backyard. I would take like plastic bins and I put random plants I would find and I mix water with it. And I didn't know what I was doing, but I kind of like knew what I was doing in a way, right? So my whole world changed once I met my naturopath, Debbie. I had very severe food allergies, and Western medicine for a year can take them away. And this lady, in one appointment, cleared me entirely of my food allergies using NAET. It's alternative medicine therapy. And it really changed my world, because she opened me up to this idea that there's something beyond the physical, beyond what we see with our and know with our five senses, right? So after that, we moved to Colorado, and once again, I was sort of driven to alternative medicine. I got very sick with adrenal fatigue syndrome. Once again, Western medicine didn't help. They tell me I wasn't dying, so I was okay, which wasn't true. So I went to another naturopath, was immediately diagnosed, put on supplements, and over the course of 5 years, they were very challenging years, I met over 50 different practitioners in the alternative medicine world, and that completely opened so many things. And I call that sort of adopting the wounded healer archetype. So in Native American practice, shamans are often chosen by being very ill and going through the healing process themselves. And by being the wounded healer and going through that process, you know that you have the compassion for other people who've gone through something, so you've been there yourself and you want to help them through their journey. So as far as I was concerned, that was my time, my awakening, the time that I was chosen. So I got a Reiki certification at a very young age, at 15, through meeting all these practitioners. I got my Reiki 1 and 2 certification, then I got my 3 when I was 20, and I got an art degree in college. I was very passionate about art, but was also very terrified of painting. I was very perfectionistic, my friends and family know. And college sort of broke me out of that, because with deadlines and all that, you don't have time to waver and to be scared anymore. So I started to do spiritual work, such as these. These weren't specifically in college, but these are Reiki finger paintings. So I would basically channel the Reiki out of my hands as I would paint with my fingers. So I've been trying to find ways to combine art and healing. So I initially wanted to be a Reiki master full time, but life had different plans for me. I'm sure as you all experience, right? You have some sort of direction you think you're gonna go, and the universe kicks you in the butt and says, nope, you're gonna go in this way. So my lovely mother is in the pink shirt here. We moved to Sedona, and I got this job at a Native American jewelry store. Once again, animal medicine and totems were sort of introduced to me, and I was able to meet some amazing Native American shamans and members of the Native American tribes that were local. So Navajo, Hopi were the main ones. And I really found even more magic with the animals. We would sell little animal totems in our store. So this was not what I was meant to do, selling at this jewelry store. I felt I was meant to do my work, but this was a very important time because it was a time I learned a lot of life lessons and met these amazing shamans I would have not otherwise had the connection to. So I started new life in Flagstaff, Arizona. I tried to get a part-time job and absolutely couldn't. Again, universe kicked me in the butt, said, nope, no, you're not. You're going to do your own thing. So I decided to be a full-time artist, which was the very scariest thing I've ever done in my life as a 22-year-old, you know. So I was very secluded and reclusive. I spent many hours a week doing anything to get my business off the ground. I'd see my boyfriend once a weekend, and that was my social time. So I had really tried hard to make my business successful. I started doing Twitch streams. So there's this website called Twitch where I could live stream my drawings and paintings. And I started doing animal portraits. And the first one was the elephant portrait. And there's just something more about the portrait that really touched me deeply. It wasn't about just drawing the animal and the anatomy of the animal. It was really feeling the essence of the elephant. And on these streams, I was starting to talk about the medicine that I knew from my experience of being ill and learning about the animals during that time. So, you know, I talk about the elephant, how it's all about compassion, compassionate leadership. And I said, you know, like, why am I not doing something with this? I have this knowledge of the medicine, this passion for the animals, and I'm drawing the animals. I may as well do something with it. And there was one day in particular, I was really struggling. I was thinking, sort of, life brought me to its knees, right? I was financially struggling. I was kind of, I felt alone in this starting of my own business. And I had this feeling to go to a spot in the forest. And I, usually whenever I do this, I'm always greeted with some sort of animal of sorts, you know, some sort of message, some sign, something. And for 30 minutes, there was nothing. I mean, I swear to God, a bird didn't chirp. Like, I didn't hear or see anything. And I was like, what the heck, universe? You know, insert profanities. and I was thinking, you know, should I be getting another job? Should I be doing something different? Like what's the deal here? So I was like, fine, you know, I'm just gonna leave. I'm gonna figure this out myself. I get up, I look at my feet, and there I saw the smallest little tarantulas, maybe about this big, and most people would have flipped out. But from that story of knowing tarantulas growing up, I was so excited and so touched. First of all, it's very rare to see, like I said, tarantulas during the day. I was also in the mountain at a very high elevation. It's higher even than here in Denver. And I didn't even know tarantulas existed at that elevation. And I've never seen one so small. It was just so precious. So I followed it. And as I followed it, I realized it was kind of going on this part that didn't have grass. And I kind of like looked up and I realized there was literally this path, like this human walked path that I had completely missed, that I was right next to. So it was like the tarantula was showing me the way. So I immediately looked on my phone. I researched what tarantulas mean. And I quote, I found the message. It says, "You are being asked to be patient for that moment. All that you are asking for is coming to fruition behind the scenes. You must step back and allow it all to take hold in a solid foundation. Moving too soon can create an instability that will undermine all of your hard work. Trust that you will be given the information and knowledge you need for your next move when the time comes." Alternatively, the tarantula can also be letting you know that positive changes are not taking hold in your life, but they are now, and it's time to integrate the spiritual with the physical. Trust your intuition and continue to move forward. So, tears streaming down my cheeks, I was very touched, and I trusted. I chose to trust. So that's when the oracle card deck idea came to me, that I should be making an oracle card deck with all of these portraits I'm doing and this passion for animals. So I actually had a psychic friend that had told me before this, months before, that I was going to make an oracle card deck, and I had completely forgotten that. And once I had announced it to my friends and family, she reminded me, and I couldn't believe like the synchronicity, because I had completely forgotten about it. So to me, that was validation. This was what I'm supposed to do. So I had my work ahead of me. I made 44 different portraits. I made many more than that, but these were the ones I chose for my deck. And it's this guy right here. It's taken a year to make this. It finally has gotten printed. This is the first event I'm selling them at, which is extremely exciting. So I have the description book, which has all of the descriptions, and the 44 cards that have all the different animals. So anyways, it was a big challenge to make this deck, because every animal has so many different archetypes and meanings, and different meaning. Everyone's interpretation is a little different. You know, you look across cultures, and oftentimes they're similar, but they vary so much. So my challenge was taking all of these qualities and making one character out of each animal to put in this deck. So an example of that is the rabbit. They are a symbol of abundance, celebration, fertility, survival, senses, intuition, vulnerability, love, desire, and more. Those are very different qualities, so how do I put that into one character? So I really thought about the essence of the rabbit. What is the rabbit doing in its environment, and how is that relevant to us? So I think about the rabbit, you know, they're eating copious amounts of grass all day. If they're in open fields, a hawk could swoop in at any moment and just take them. And then what do they do once they actually recede into their dens? They're making babies like there's no tomorrow, right? So they're beautiful symbols of abundance. And I called them, the archetype I assigned them was the partier, because they're celebrating always, despite their vulnerabilities, despite their stress, their problems. I mean, the rabbits may not have problems. I guess you don't, that's what we can think, right? But if, from the human perspective, when we take that and we focus it on how can that help us, we can say, oh, that could be a motivational message for us to say, make sure you're celebrating, make sure you're enjoying life, despite whatever's happening. So I did that for all 44 animals, and yes, it's been a very exciting endeavor. So I'm selling these for $30 each, or two for $50. After making this deck, and while I was waiting for it to get printed, I was absolutely thrown into the animal conservation world. I manifested one animal conservation event, which I met another person there, that got me to another event, met a person there, got me to another event, and the chain continued. And I felt very called to animal conservation in general. It's like the animals were calling me. So I really was, my eyes were open to the Earth's problems. And the first one I was part of was the Wolf Week in Sedona in April. And I really understood the extremely inhumane way that wolves are being trapped. And it's something that we here in Colorado don't see. But in Wyoming, there's a lot of animosity, and people even give death threats. That's how passionate they are about trapping animals, trapping these wolves especially. Have any of you heard of the idea that wolves have changed the riverbanks in Yellowstone? Does anyone want to describe that for me? Go for it, yeah.
I think, I want to say it was about 14 wolves that were reintroduced. They noticed the population was waning, so they put 14 back. And then all of a sudden they started to see that the deer population that was overblown started to shrink, and then vegetation started to grow, and then all this other wildlife started coming back, the otters and the beavers and everything.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and then eventually I think it changed the direction of the river.
Right.
Something.
Yeah, so the grassroots stabilized the riverbanks. So by having the wolves, it affected the entire ecosystem. They were the apex predators. And unless we understand ecology, unless we understand that point, and we just kill wolves without thinking about it, that's gonna happen. So it's a very beautiful concept to me, where interconnectedness is really shown. I also watched the documentary called Blackfish. Have you all heard of Blackfish? It's very harrowing. I see a harrowed face in the audience, yes. It's a very harrowing documentary. It's all about SeaWorld and the other places that have taken orcas and other marine mammals for entertainment's sake, for our entertainment. And essentially orca babies are taken from their pods and shipped across the world, because I mean, it depends where they're getting them. They put them in very small cages, and the equivalent for us would be a human bathtub, and they're in there for decades. So what's very terrible about that is that orcas live with their pod their entire lives. They are family oriented, and they have a bigger portion in their brain that's dedicated to processing emotions. So we have really no idea like what that does to the creature and how abusive that is. They also develop psychosis when they're in captivity, especially for that long. They fight when they're in close quarters with each other. And even if you put two orcas in the same tank, like it's the equivalent of putting, you know, some other language speaking person, you know, in the bathtub with you, like it's not gonna help the situation, you know? So we're like, oh, they have friends, like it's okay. And no, that's not the case. So if you've heard of like SeaWorld trainers being injured or even killed, it's due to that psychosis state, and obviously SeaWorld covers it up. They actually will tell basically lies in the guise of facts. And it's kind of a convoluted issue, right? Because with SeaWorld, you do have this push for recognizing animals and respecting animals and natures, and I think that's really important. But I also think that for the individuals involved, that's incredibly terrible, and we shouldn't be doing that as humans, and for entertainment too. I think it's just kind of sick. I also read Lawrence Anthony's The Elephant Whisperer. He's a conservationist and a reserve owner in South Africa. And he basically takes on a herd of elephants that were wild, and he finds a way to connect to them. It's a beautiful, beautiful book. I cried maybe 7 times. Like, it's amazing. But I learned about the cruelty of poaching, as well as even his efforts, which were so extensive to save these elephants in a reserve. It's like a crazy uphill battle. Poachers still will come into the reserve, and it's really impossible to like protect all of the wildlife. Two other events I was part of was Katie's Night, that was just recently. That was a silent auction to raise money for animals. I was also part of the Running Wild race, which also raised money for animals. But I was just, again, introduced to animal conservation. And I think my role here isn't to just know and understand animal conservation. It's sort of taking this one issue of the animals and taking it big picture. So I think my role here in using this deck maybe and being here with you lovely people today is to connect us back to nature as a whole. It's beyond the animals, you know, but I'm using the animals as a vessel. So if we think about our ancestors, you can study tribes from around the world. I know in Papua New Guinea, as well as the Bushmen in Africa, even Native Americans, there's always this reverence when hunting an animal. You know, the hunters will even describe it as they connect with an animal spirit. They sense the animal, they know where to go, and they feel that the animal is actually telling them where they are because they want to support the humans. Like, it's a very interesting idea. But really, what I find beautiful about that is that there's this respect and this sort of spiritual nature in the hunting and feeding process. When you compare that to our food here, we have no connection to the living beings that we eat, for the most part, I mean, unless you go out of your way. You know, we pick up packaged meat, packaged flesh, really, in containers, and our produce, where we don't know where it came from, what's sprayed on it, what's in it, we have no idea. I think we've really come away from that. There's also the Hopi people, and I learned from my time at the Native American Jewelry Store, how rich their culture is. There's hundreds of stories of the animal spirits. They basically sort of made these characters, similar to how I'm making archetypes in my deck, created these characters, and they would actually embody them. They would dress up as these animals, and they would dance sort of as a way to thank the animal spirits that they believed were sort of godly for their fertility, for their plants, for the water, the rain. And there's just gratitude for all life. You see that sort of consistently when you look at our old tribes. So now, again, when you compare that to here, what we have now, I think we've lost this sort of reverence in our daily culture, this present-day American culture we have here. And you could say even worldwide, especially first world countries, right? When industry kind of enters, has to push the nature out a little bit. So I'm not suggesting, per se, we need to live out, you know, completely like the Bushmen in Africa or the people of Papua New Guinea, per se, but I think it's important to really maintain that respect for nature that I think we've lost. So I've had an ecology background a little bit, and I think when you really understand ecology, like I was talking about with the wolves in Yellowstone, you can't really not see that interconnectedness, and I think that is a way where you can take something like science, something that's grounded, and then develop something that's more of a spiritual nature, right? So I think it's not surprising that this is the way it is in our culture, because I think we're subliminally programmed to know that we know everything, to not ask questions, to make assumptions about things, and to believe that our overall success as individuals is through that 9-to-5 job, you know, getting married, having the kids, having a big house, having the white picket fence with the grass lawn. Don't get me started on grass lawns, because that's a whole other conversation of problems. And we have all the amenities and materials that we want. We have access to all the materials and amenities that we want. But it's all about consumerism, this feeling that it's never enough. We are not enough, and Doesn't matter how much we have, we're just never going to be fulfilled. So, how you talked about food. Oh, and we're given smartphones to boot. So if we're not distracted enough between our jobs and our cars and, you know, not spending time with our family and or spending time in our homes that we're paying the money for, you know, going to our job for, we have our smartphones to interrupt us for every moment in between. And I would say, arguably, as a culture, we've never really been lonelier and more disconnected from one another. So nature can show us connection and cooperation. I talked about the wolves. I'll give some more examples. Does anyone know what the largest organism on the planet is? Can throw out answers.
Aspen?
You're on the right track. It's not the blue whale.
Maybe the mushroom.
Yes, yes. In eastern Oregon, there is a mycelium map of the honey fungus. It's 2,200 acres wide and 2,000 years old, and it's one cell wall thick. Isn't that exceptional? I mean, can we even fathom like how big that is and how, it's mind-blowing to me.
What's it called?
Honey fungus.
Oh, okay.
I would highly recommend watching Paul Stamets, S-T-A-M-E-T-S, his TED Talk of 6 Ways Mushrooms Can Save the World. It's a beautiful documentary. He's the scientist behind doing studies on how mushrooms can clean up, the overflow from factories and things. He'll actually plant mushrooms there, and it cleans, it absorbs the toxins. Like I forget exactly which factories he puts these outside of, but I highly recommend watching it anyways. It's a beautiful video. So I talked about Lawrence Anthony and the Elephant Whisperer. It's another example of connection through elephants. They communicate through stomach rumblings, and I think they can also make very low frequency sounds through their trunks and their throats, and they can communicate from many, many miles away. He has this example of when these very intelligent and unruly elephant herd escaped from his reserve, and they planned it, because they're smart enough to know how the humans track them. So they had broken out at night. They put the electric fence around their tusks and charged out 7,000 volts. They withstood to break out, and they basically split in half. They had the two, the matriarch and the matriarch sister. They basically spread out. They were miles apart, I think 4 to 7 miles, and then they reconnected. They came back in thick bush at night. After being miles apart, they met exactly at the same point. Now, if they couldn't hear, they'd have no idea where they were if they didn't have that level of communication. And that's something even we don't really understand. Another really amazing thing that I guess science hasn't touched yet is the idea that they can even connect further hundreds of miles away. So Lawrence, the author of this book, was very close to the animals. When he would go on vacation, basically, here's this reserve, right? It's a huge reserve. His home's on one end. The elephants were always outside of the reserve, but they would come visit him. When he would come back from vacation, they would know exactly when he left. They'd be there before he left. He would leave, he'd come back, and they would be there. And one of the most amazing stories with that was that there was one time where he was about to fly back from Europe to South Africa. His flight got delayed. And the rangers that were watching the elephants had said that they were on their way to the reserve and that they stopped in their tracks right at the moment that he found out he was delayed, and they turned around and went back to do whatever they were going to do. So like that, I mean, this unbelievable connection, again, that science hasn't touched yet. We don't really fully understand it. Even after Lawrence had passed away, unfortunately, they came to his home to give grievance to him as if he was a member of the elephant family. They knew when he died, they came there. I mean, it's unbelievable. Another example of connection in nature is tree roots. There's another amazing TED Talk by Suzanne Simmer. She's a Canadian scientist. She worked with trees. She planted different trees next to each other and had basically devoid certain ones of certain nutrients. And she had found that trees actually share their nutrients with each other through their roots. I obviously, being the sap that I am, was bawling when I was watching this TED Talk. It was the most beautiful thing I'd ever heard. But the idea is that they can help other trees. So she was saying that if we, instead of deforesting forests completely, right, removing all the trees from the forest at once, we could take some trees away and then replant new ones, or new saplings grow naturally, right? And they grow faster, quicker, better, happier, because they're next to their other community of mother trees, as she called them. So another place we see our connection, connection nature, is through in our own body. So does anyone know off the top of their head how many cells are in the human body? Approximately. Do you want to guess? What?
Trillion.
A trillion. Any other guesses?
3 trillion?
3 trillion. You're in the right direction. There are 37.2 trillion cells in our human body. When you really imagine all of our cells, the different kinds of cells, right, all working together to be one human body, one individual thinking thing, I think we humans can learn from our own cells how to cooperate better with each other, right? DNA replication is even more efficient than anything we can do with our own human hands. I think it's between 98% to 99.5%, something like that. It's really incredible. So with these lessons of cooperation, connection that we learn from nature, how can we reconnect? Every animal conservation event I've been to has said the same thing. We need to be educating ourselves and educating especially our children for the future generations, because I think a good portion of us old people now are lost souls, right? If we can't be convinced now, we gotta start them young. Jamie Oliver, who is in charge of the food revolution, he went to schools and talked to little kids and asked them if they knew what vegetables were. He showed them cauliflowers and celery and potatoes, and not one of them could identify what it was. They had no idea. These kids were 6 to 7 years old. They had no idea what vegetables were. So I think food harvesting is a really great way to get our kids interested. I think it's in general important to know where our food comes from. And it's always the implications beyond that, right? It's not just saying, you know, vegetables come from the earth and you know, we have meat from cows. It's thinking about that there's consequences for things. You know, there's food isn't just stocked in a store. It doesn't appear like it comes from something. There's work that goes into it. So we teach kids that it's beyond that. And another example too is the Apex Foundation. So when I was part of the Sedona Wolf Week, we had actually were working with the Apex Foundation, which are a group of people who take on wolf dogs. So these are dogs that are bred with wolf DNA, and they're not exactly sure what the percentage is, but essentially you're putting part wild animal into domestic animal and you're selling it as a domestic animal. So obviously people who have torn up houses now that adopted a wolf dog, they don't want that wolf dog, so they have to get euthanized. So this place takes on the wolf dogs, they take care of them, give them what they need, and they take these dogs after socializing them into schools. They teach kids, they share their story. So that, you know, that's a specific issue, and that's something you could say, you know, does something small for children, but I think it's quite the opposite. Because what you're doing is you're teaching empathy to children. You're saying that there's something outside of you that is also important, you know? Anyone who's babysat children or watched children know that they sort of grow up with their ego very well intact. Their ego is very apparent, you know? So they have the beautiful capability to love and give and share, but they also have to know how to sort of work with their ego and keep that in check. So I think by teaching empathy, that's a way that we can do that. So when we're paired with this open-mindedness, I think we're able to recognize issues outside of the self. I think we can then, after that, ask questions, understand implications of problems. And as individuals, we have to muster our courage to fight. So I think that's sort of the 3 steps we have to take as, you know, inhabitants of Mother Earth in our fight to protect her. So in sharing this awareness, I think there's limitless possibilities of how we can do that. I think we're all given gifts and we're all on our path for a reason. We're all special in our own way. An example of how I differ from someone else is my amazing brother, Scott, is an exceptionally brilliant engineer. I got the pleasure of watching him grow up, and I saw how he had this amazing intelligence, this ability to problem solve, and this passion to really understand how things worked. And we both really grew up with a desire to help, and that was what we had in common. But the way we did things and the way we work is so different. So while he's doing, you know, very hands-on applications to help the world, here I am, you know, sort of making my little hippie deck and all that. But I think we all have something to contribute. It's important to think about that and honor our own gifts. I think our culture often says we're not where we need to be. So I was talking about consumerism and how it's never enough. But the importance is in following our inner guidance, following the beat to our own drum. And if you don't know what that is, what your own beat is yet, I think the animals can help. So I'll talk more about the animals now. So we've all heard of spirit, power, totem, animal. Even people who aren't more spiritually conscious have heard of spirit, power, and totem animals. I refrain from using the word totem animal just because totem comes from the Northwest tribes, totem poles, and I personally am not affiliated with that. And like from my experience at Native American jewelry stores and all that, I don't want to disrespect the culture, you know. So I usually call it animal essence or animal spirit. But despite using those different terms, I think the intention is the same that Native American spirit medicine uses. So with Native American spirit medicine, I mean, it's a huge term, and you're talking about like 500 plus tribes in North America. So it's hard to pinpoint exactly what that is. But if we just take a general view, it's sort of about learning from observing and even embodying the animals' ways. So I talked about the Hopi people and how they like even dress up as the animals and dance as them. So tribes would even, or individuals would have their names associated with animals, right? I just met someone yesterday, this lovely lady who said she was a Navajo woman from the Wolf Clan. So again, we're, you know, using animals in this way where they're affiliated with us. So I've noticed oftentimes the favorite animal we had growing up, or even the animals that come up recently in your life, you may have just, you know, I know my friend Ricky here has really enjoyed the tiger recently. I think there's a reason for that, and oftentimes that favorite animal matches the life path that you're on or the life lessons you're on. They can help, they either match it or it's like the opposite lesson that you need to learn, if that makes sense. So an example of that is I've loved dolphins ever since I can remember. Their main themes are breathing, balance and harmony, and altruism. So what's the longest that anyone can hold their breath? Do you guys know? Do you swim a lot? How long can you hold your breath underwater?
Yeah.
Or not?
Average person? Or?
Just the longest anyone here can hold their breath.
Oh, I think 50 seconds to a minute.
50 seconds to a minute? Anyone top that?
Mm-hmm. When I was younger, though.
I could either.
Mm-hmm. When I was younger than that now.
So dolphins can hold their breath for 15 minutes. And these are mammals we're talking about. They don't have gills. They're breathing oxygen just like everyone else. They're able to do this because they have extra myoglobin in their muscles. So myoglobin is what makes your muscles red. Their muscles are like purple or black. So they have a lot of myoglobin, and what myoglobin does is it stores oxygen. So they have these really efficient circulatory systems. So how that's relevant to me specifically is I have diaphragm problems and short breath. So the dolphin, it's interesting how it, you know, mimics my ability to not breathe well. So it can teach me better. Harmony and balance, that was the second quality I said. Dolphins live between two worlds, as like some of the natives would say, because they're in the water, but they're mammals, so they breathe air. We think of yin and yang, duality, Taoism. I personally struggle to balance my passions and my time. The third quality, altruism, is I call the dolphin the caregiver in my card deck. And there's countless stories of dolphins saving humans. Even pregnant women have been saved from like dolphins when sharks were, you know, about to attack. So that interspecies care, I talked about the tree roots, the trees, it didn't matter what species they were, they would give nutrients to any tree. But that's pretty rare in nature to see in general. So how that's relevant to me is ever since I was a little girl, I always wanted to be of help, whether it was a career related or just, you know, on a day-to-day basis or socially. If that wasn't enough, I also love the ocean and water, so I'm a dolphin girl. I call myself a dolphin. So if you guys are drawn to an animal like that and you haven't yet researched it, I highly recommend looking it up. You could always look up the spiritual qualities, or you could also even look at their behavior and how they act in the world and make your own interpretations. I think it's really important to look at your own interpretations. And even in my deck, I make sure I say that because I'm one person and everyone has their different ways of thinking, so it's my own interpretation. I think it's very difficult to see oneself, and when we have these animals that are closely connected to us. Their ways can help reflect to us who we are. They can help us rediscover who we are. I think we're all connected to all animals despite that. So we can call on any animal spirit and they come to us. They can either come to us or we can find them. It's sort of a mixed bag. An example, let's say if the panda comes up to you. Let's say you're driving back from home and you want to go to Panda Express. And on the way to Panda Express, you see a panda bumper sticker. And then you pick up your Panda Express and you're like, oh, that's funny. Then you go home, turn on the TV to hear Panda Express, and then there's a panda documentary on. Obviously, the panda's trying to tell you something. So if we were to look at the panda's lifestyle, they're all about conserving energy. So they eat only bamboo. They basically spend a lot of their time sitting and eating because bamboo is very low, has low nutritional content. So they literally don't have the energy to do what they can do. So they can climb, they can swim, but they don't have the energy. So if we look at our own lives, how do we relate that to ourselves? Could you be needing to conserve energy? Are you working too hard? You could also look at that and say, is my diet not have enough nutrients? Do I need more nutrients in my diet? So that's an example of how we can take an animal sign and reflect it back on us. The interpretation, like I said, depends on you. Also, sometimes the message comes in the future. So the chipmunk shows up to you in some way, shape, or form. They're signs of abundance or good luck. So maybe you get that sign and you're like, cool, like I guess it's abundance, good luck, and then the next day you win the lottery, you know, or you get an unexpected check in the mail. So the timing is always interesting, and sometimes you gotta respect that, like, the sign could come to you later. You know, you might piece the puzzle together later. So the way that this works, I think, is through the law of attraction. I imagine a lot of you know what that is or have at least heard the term. And the idea is that everything's vibrating molecules, right? And we vibrate at our own frequency. Every thought, feeling, emotion, anything creates a vibration. So when we think, say, feel, we are our vibration's constantly changing. So like energy attracts like energy. So when we use those words, thoughts, and feelings to attract what we want, and we apply that with the animals, we can live a happier life. So an example of using this is, let's say I'm driving down the road and I see a cop and I'm like, oh shit, I was driving a little too fast, oh man. And I don't want to be seen, right? An animal that's used for camouflage, not the actual animal, but the symbolism is camouflage, as well as elusiveness. They're the escape artists in my deck, is the fox. So the fox actually will make multiple escape routes in their den in case a predator comes in. They're very smart and tricky creatures, very clever. So a way that I can use the fox to help me is to, really it's up to you, you have to be creative, but you have to think it, feel it, say it, whatever works best for you. So some people could imagine the image of a fox on top of their car protecting them. You could just say, thank you, spirit of the fox, for helping me not be seen by the cop. There's different ways to embody that, and I highly encourage you to be creative and see what happens. So nature can really express to us animal signs through the interactions. It's always interesting and important to look at the way that the animal's interacting with you. So I was on a hike with my lovely friend Ricky the other day. We found some hawk feathers. We found two, actually, which I've never found a hawk feather before on my own, and to find two I thought was kind of interesting. So it's a symbol of protection and guidance, and I thought that was very relevant at the time. So the tarantula I mentioned before, it was showing me the path, it was showing me the way when it literally crawled on that path that I didn't see. There's also, when animals block your car or they're on the road and you're about to hit them, they're in your path. You know, that's a way that you can interpret that. That's also why I made the deck, was to, no matter what, you can't go wrong, you're always going to pick an animal sign, so you're never going to be lost. You know, if you ask for an animal sign and the animals don't come to you, this is a way to use them. So my hopes with this deck and in my work is to bridge the gap between industry and nature and to yield an appreciation of the animals. I think once we yield that empathy for animals, we yield empathy for much greater than that. We have the capability to. And here we're fighting over whether climate change is real or not, and like, we don't have time for that. We don't have time to fight over that. And I think we really need to be able to see and feel what's going on beyond ourselves. So it's all in the subliminal messages and the implications, the smaller things that end up being greater things. So I do believe we have a chance to save the planet. I think it takes a collective effort. And while we're one person, I think the more one persons we have doing something, the closer we are to making a greater change. So I think I've had trouble coming to terms with being a consumer. So I think in the society, it's kind of, you know, doing that. I had to use gas to drive here and to load all my stuff. You know, it's like we have to use energy. We have to survive in this society. My biggest message to come home with is to always do our best to educate ourselves and to be open-minded. If I don't know something about an issue, I do my best to really try and understand everything about it so that I know that I'm being somewhat thoughtful and connected. So albeit small, the efforts can, let's say with the cow industry, right? There, I just learned the number one contributor to greenhouse gases. So I can reduce my meat and dairy consumption. Bottom line is basically to be open-minded, compassionate human beings to help the world in our own way. I want to thank you all so much for coming and listening to my speech today. So if you have any more questions, yes.
With this being the time of the sixth greatest extinction of animals on the planet, like we're losing 250 species a day, I find myself regularly being overwhelmed.
Yeah.
You know, especially with all the swarm of humans and the construction and the building and habitat loss. I mean, I feel helpless and hopeless a lot.
Yeah.
Of times.
I actually have a card for you that I can, you'd probably even take this card if that's what you're feeling today strongly. The prairie dog is a member of a huge society, right? And they all function. I don't have time to like talk too much in detail about it, but basically, they work really hard to protect one another. So I call them the citizen. And the message of the citizen card, and I think is so relevant during our times, especially with our government, is that we're all getting so overwhelmed. There's so much happening, and we think, what can we do as a person to change this? And I think the best way we can do that is to focus on your own gifts and to channel that and just do what you need to do, and that's it. You know, you can't worry about beyond that. You just got to do what you have to do. And that's really the best message I can share.
I do.
I'm with you. I feel you.
I send money.
Yeah, beautiful.
And so there's probably not a whole bunch else I can do.
Right, I'm with you, absolutely. Thank you so much.